WNYC Studios.
So we are slouching our way to the end of what could only be characterized as a very interesting year. And so I'm going to ask you, have you done it yet? Have you donated to On the Media? Because I know you're out there. We're talking to you. We need you. And you're with us, so I suspect you need us too. Lend us a hand. Text OTM to 69866. That's OTM 69866. Or go to onthemedia.org and hit the donate button. It doesn't take any time, but we could sure use the help and the vote of confidence. Thanks a lot, and have a great new year. From WNYC in New York, this is On the Media. I'm Brooke Gladstone.
And I'm Bob Garfield. This week, less than a month to go before Inauguration Day, President Obama seemed to be rushing through his bucket list. Or maybe his rhymes with bucket list.
The president placed a ban on oil and gas drilling in nearly all the country's Arctic waters and large sections of the Atlantic Ocean.
President Obama is delivering a generous parting gift to Planned Parenthood in the form of a rule prohibiting states from divesting millions of dollars from the nation's largest abortion provider.
The Obama administration says it is ending a dormant program that was once used to track mostly Muslim men entering the United States. The program is called National Security Entry Exit Registration System, or NSEERS for short.
A busy week. But for advocates who are watching the minutes tick down to the Trump administration, not nearly busy enough. So we're going to spend much of this show considering what the president could do and what some people wish he would do in order to safeguard some basic American principles. First, as to that Muslim registry, otherwise known as NSEERS, that item was disposed of this week, but we still had some questions, so we put them to ACLU senior staff attorney Omar Jadwat.
The way it worked was that they added countries to a list, and if you were from one of those countries, then you'd be required to abide by the special NSEERS rules. So in 2011, they reduced the number of countries on that list to zero so that there were no countries on the list whose nationals were subject to NSEERS.
What this administration is doing now is discarding the regulation altogether.
That's correct. There is no longer a regulatory framework under which this administration or any future administration can designate a bunch of countries and say, if you're from one of these countries, you need to do all the following special things in order to stay in this country.
NSEERS was replaced by a still broader program that exposed still more people to scrutiny.
Some people point to U.S. Visit as a broader version of the NSEERS program, and it's true that U.S. Visit did some of the tracking work that was part of what NSEERS supposedly was designed to do, that is, keep track of when people entered the country and when they left it, and when their authorizations to be here on a temporary visit were supposed to expire. But the U.S. Visit program didn't and doesn't include this discriminatory aspect of NSEERS in that it targets only people of a certain religion and or national origin. And it also doesn't include the interviews that were part of NSEERS that were a means by which the government discovered totally unrelated problems with people's immigration status that they then used to try to remove people.
Has the Obama administration really accomplished anything? Cannot the Trump administration, with the stroke of a pen, simply recreate NSEERS?
Not with the stroke of a pen. They would have to go through a rulemaking process that involves publishing notice and soliciting comments from the public and responding to those comments. If NSEERS was a loaded gun sitting on the table, at the very least, the administration has removed the bullets and locked them in a separate room.
Omar, thank you very much.
Thanks.
Omar Jadwat is a senior staff attorney at the American Civil Liberties Union.
The White House dismantled the Muslim registry with a rule change from the Department of Homeland Security. It protected funding for Planned Parenthood with a rule from the Department of Health and Human Services. Such agency rulemakings don't go through Congress, and while they're not Trump-proof, they're cumbersome to repeal or reinstate. Another tool at the president's disposal is the executive order, which also skirts congressional approval, but can be easily undone by incoming President Trump. Though Obama has always stated a preference for legislative solutions, congressional leaders resisted those. So in his two terms, he's issued 267 orders addressing climate change, LGBT discrimination, and much more.
One more such order could in part address what the president himself has called, quote, a threat to our democracy, the Supreme Court's Citizens United decision, and the increasing impact of untraceable dark money on elections. The Brennan Center's Daniel Weiner.
We've advocated for the president to issue an executive order requiring large government contractors to disclose most of their political spending. Large amounts are allowed to remain secret, and, you know, we think an executive order could fix that.
Now, there are rules already in place, are there not, that prohibit certain contributions from federal contractors?
There is a prohibition on contracting individual or entities giving directly to candidates and political parties. And on its face, that prohibition might also cover super PACs and dark money groups. But it has been interpreted only to apply literally to the entity that holds the contract. So a wholly owned subsidiary would not be subject to the prohibition, likewise a parent corporation. And what we're really talking about here are large, often multinational corporations that have, you know, hundreds if not thousands of different affiliates. And so essentially the law that's on the books right now does very little work.
In case this isn't altogether obvious, in a Citizens United era in which the law of the land says that corporations are allowed to give money just like any individual, should contractors be prohibited from contributing to political figures?
Well, look, the public has a strong interest in making sure that when the government procures services from the private sector, it gets the best bang for its buck, and that contracting decisions are made based on merit, not based on, you know, who's best at playing a political money game.
All right, let's just say you get your way and the president issues an executive order banning certain kinds of contributions or requiring much more transparency than we have now. Why wouldn't Trump just come in and rescind it?
I would argue that someone who campaigned partly on, quote, draining the swamp and sounded notes very similar almost to Bernie Sanders about the corrosive influence of big money on American politics might want to think twice before rescinding a pretty common sense protection for taxpayer dollars.
You know, I'm sorry. And I'm just laughing at what you said.
So here's the deal. Here's the deal. Look, you're right to laugh. Hope springs eternal for me. We would have said that President Obama should have done this a long time ago, but he didn't. This is what he can do now. And then it'll be up to President Trump to show whether he actually intends to keep his promises.
Daniel Weiner serves as senior counsel for the Brennan Center's Democracy Program.
The president could also use his power to declassify sensitive documents, because obviously the public can't unknow what's been disclosed. For instance, transparency advocates have urged Obama to release the full text of the Senate's torture report, fearing that the Trump White House might destroy the few existing copies. Last week, the White House announced that one copy would be archived among Obama's presidential papers, so it won't be destroyed, but it won't be declassified for 12 years either.
So much to disclose, so little time, particularly about the U.S. surveillance apparatus and the drone program, both largely shrouded in secrecy. Prothop Chatterjee is the managing editor of the public interest group Corp Watch. Recently in The Nation, he advised three actions for this president to help keep the next president in check.
To publish, to punish, and to pardon.
To shed light on what in particular?
The Obama administration has conducted 473 drone strikes in Libya, Pakistan, Somalia, and Yemen between 2008 and the end of 2016. And it has killed at least 2,500 people. However, how the president chooses who to kill is a secret. In the last 6 months, the Obama administration has released some documents suggesting that it relies on a principle that it defines as near certainty that a target is a quote-unquote terrorist before it issues an order to execute them. But we don't exactly know what that means. Donald Trump himself has said he is going to go after ISIS. So when he says that he has killed somebody based on his decision that this person's a terrorist or not, we have no way of telling that this was any different from what President Obama did unless we have access to those very rules.
That's drones. What would you like the administration on its way out to reveal about surveillance programs?
We know the U.S. government has regularly received permission from the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court to collect all U.S. telephone metadata via programs like StellarWind. We know about a program called PRISM, which allowed the U.S. government to tunnel directly into the servers of nine major internet companies like Google and Yahoo and Apple. We know that they tapped the global fiber optic cables that lie on the ocean beds that connect the countries. We know that they set up a vast database called X-Keyscore to track all data from any given individual. And that they've even built a program called Optic Nerve to turn on users' webcams. We now know, thanks to a Freedom of Information Act request that was made by the New York Times, that many of these programs resulted in data that was relatively useless. 99% of that data is actually information on innocent people. That's a real threat to civil liberties.
There's another slightly less prominent threat that you see, and that has to do with contracts between the government and private companies for data.
For example, AT&T has agreements with police forces around the country to pay them for data on private citizens in order to track people down. What I would ask the Obama administration to do is to publish the details of these contracts so we know under what circumstances this data is made available to the government, so we could choose how to protect our own data.
Obama's created a rather robust precedent for his successor. Never mind what you want him to do now. Shouldn't he have thought of this 8 years ago?
Being a law professor, he believed that you could make change through executive order, that the right decisions could actually enforce civil liberties and protect citizens from terrorism. But what he actually did was create a system by which he alone, the president alone, got to choose who to target, whose data to collect, and who to put into jail. I think it behooves Obama, if he wants to have a legacy of being transparent, if he wants to be seen as a champion of civil liberties, to apologize for some of his mistakes, to ensure that future presidents do not have access to the kinds of tools that, in fact, have been abused in the last 8 years.
Prothap, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Prothap Chatterjee is the managing editor of Corp Watch, a public interest watchdog organization. So, any other intractable problems lying around? Oh, how about Guantanamo? The Miami Herald's Carol Rosenberg has covered the detention camp since it opened in 2002. In recent visits there, she's noted a change in the atmosphere, perhaps embodied best in an interaction involving a prisoner and his artwork.
Khalid Qasim is a Yemeni man who's been at Guantanamo for coming up on 15 years. He's what we call a forever prisoner. He's a man who has not been cleared for release, but he's taken an art class down there. And I was on a tour, a visit to the lockup for cooperative captives called Camp 6, and Qasim realized that the media was there. So Qasim scrambles and gets a piece of art, and it's a question mark. And instead of a dot at the bottom, there's a lock. So there was a debate inside the detention center among the leaders. It's communication, and that's generally forbidden for the media to communicate with the prisoners and for the prisoners to communicate with the media. So some of the commanders were saying, maybe we should censor the picture. Maybe we should order them to destroy it. But, you know, this is an uncertain time at Guantanamo. There's no doubt. Everybody knows this. So the decision was made that we could keep the picture of the art. And the next day when we went to an interview with Commander Clark, he used it as a metaphor for these times of uncertainty at Guantanamo Bay.
We could keep Guantanamo as is with only 59 prisoners still at the base. We could empty it, or we could, as Trump vowed during the campaign, fill it up. And nobody there knows which of those things is going to happen.
Nobody knows. So there are 59 detainees there now. 23 as of this week are cleared for release. But just because someone's cleared, it doesn't mean they open up the doors and let people out. The State Department has to negotiate resettlement or repatriation agreements. And this has become increasingly difficult since Donald Trump was elected, because some of the countries that were willing to take these people to help out President Obama recognize that now it's all about negotiating with Donald Trump. Trump campaigned on a pledge to load it up. What does load it up mean? The prison at Guantanamo was created for Al-Qaeda, the Taliban, and associates. Those organizations don't exactly exist in the same form today. So the question becomes, if they capture a pirate, if they capture someone from Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, which is Yemen, if Syria or Iraq turned over someone that they said was ISIS from the Islamic State, would that person qualify for detention at Guantanamo? It's never been tested in federal court.
Carol, what's going to happen?
In short term, I think the releases will stop on Inauguration Day. The Attorney General designate, Jeff Sessions, he's all about Guantanamo. He doesn't want to prosecute them in federal court. He said way back in 2010 that, you know, we should stop treating terrorists like civilians. That's the short term. The long term is, I don't see it at this stage ever closing. It's become too politicized and too popular with a huge portion of America. Obama tried to make the argument that this was not good for us, and it didn't work. People like Guantanamo. Congress likes Guantanamo. They like the signals it sends. I've been doing this thing since day one, and I've come to increasingly suspect that this will be the Spandau prison of our time. Rudolf Hess was 93. He died there in 1987. When he died, they tore that prison down. And to me, it just feels like this is going to become waiting for the last detainee to die before they shut that thing down.
Carol, thank you very much.
Thank you, Bob.
Carol Rosenberg covers Guantanamo Bay Prison for the Miami Herald.
Speaking of people on the wrong side of the law.
Accused Army deserter Sergeant Bo Bergdahl, transgender military secrets leaker Chelsea Manning, and exiled NSA whistleblower Edward Snowden, each looking for an 11th-hour reprieve.
Pardons. The president says he doesn't have the power to pardon Snowden.
I can't pardon somebody who hasn't been gone before a court and presented themselves.
Technically, that's not true. In federal cases, there is no restriction on the president's power to pardon. But if the president is disinclined to forgive those he believes damaged national security, he's eager to free those he says have been sentenced too harshly and for too long.
President Obama granting 78 pardons and 153 commutations Monday. That's a single-day record for the use of presidential clemency power. Altogether, he has commuted the sentences of over 1,100 inmates, the majority of those cases involving drug-related charges.
Fast work, considering that just 2 years ago he had the lowest clemency rate of any modern president. But according to activists like author and law professor Mark Osler, not fast enough. Mark, welcome to OTM.
Well, thank you.
When you think of pardons, it has acquired a bit of a smell, because Clinton pardoned a big donor, Mark Rich, and George W. Bush pardoned Scooter Libby, and famously, I guess, Ford pardoned Nixon.
Yeah, and that's one of the things that makes what President Obama has done so significant. It has been completely free of that kind of favoritism. Instead, it's gone out to people who are the least powerful, who aren't connected at all. The president writes a letter each time he's granted clemency to someone, to that prisoner, a letter from the most powerful person in the world to the least powerful person in the world. That's gone a long ways towards reclaiming the legitimacy of the pardon power.
Just Monday, he granted clemency to 231 people. The White House claimed that was the most individual acts of clemency granted in a single day in this nation's history. And that was wrong, you said.
Well, you know, President Truman pardoned 1,523 specific people in 1947. And what it obscures, unfortunately, what President Ford did, he granted clemency to almost 14,000 people who were either draft evaders or army deserters over the course of just 1 year.
In the criticisms and the defenses of President Obama's actions on clemency, there are some misconceptions, one of which is that he can grant a pardon to anybody. He really can't, can he?
No, he's limited to just the federal prisoners. And of the 2 million-some people that are in prison in the United States, only about 200,000 are in the federal prisons, and those are the people that the president can reach.
Critics say that the whole point of the pardon is to send a message, to take a political risk. Do you agree with that, or is it more important just to get the most justice to the most people as quickly as you can, no matter their crime?
No, I think the symbolism is really important. It's also a signal to prosecutors in the field. When prosecutors see that the president is having that view of these kinds of offenders, it's going to result in different charging decisions, for example. And we've seen that.
There's a lot the president could focus on right now, a lot of issues that people are hounding him to take up. With his limited time, argue for changing the way he pardons people.
This is the one issue that the Constitution puts squarely in his hands. It was actually quite controversial because it's a power of kings. And because that is solely in his hands, it's also solely his responsibility.
So he's sitting in front of me right now. You have 30 seconds to tell him what he can do right now.
Mr. President, you have groups of people who the American people know are serving sentences that are too long. For example, those who are serving crack sentences that were changed in 2010 under the Fair Sentencing Act. Identify them and boom, get it done. If you're worried about public safety, just look at how the Bureau of Prisons has classified them. Those people have assessed their dangerousness. Trust the Bureau of Prisons and make the decisions quickly.
Mark, thank you very much.
I'm so glad you're talking about this.
Mark Osler is a lawyer, author, and professor of law at the University of St. Thomas in Minneapolis.
Members of the Trump transition team have sent their own message to President Obama that climate change, in which they don't believe, does not merit study by the federal government, which has given California Governor Jerry Brown a mission.
And we got a lot of firepower. We got the scientists. We got the universities. We have the national labs. And if Trump turns off the satellites, California will launch its own damn satellite. We're going to collect that data.
Meanwhile, a small army of volunteer archivists, scientists, and advocates have been working to save the government climate change research that already exists.
At NASA and NOAA that take the temperature of the planet from weather stations, from satellites, from ocean buoys.
Meteorologist Eric Holthaus spoke to NPR about his effort to save government climate data.
Sometimes these data sets are only stored in United States government servers, so there hasn't really been an effort to catalog those in other countries because we haven't thought it was necessary before.
The Internet Archive, on the other hand, has given a lot of thought to what gets lost in presidential transitions. Every week, the archive saves 300 million web pages, and every 4 years, it enlists a bunch of volunteers to make copies of government websites as a hedge against what the next administration may choose to delete. It's called the End-of-Term Web Archive, and for some reason this year, the organizers are getting a lot more offers of help. Brewster Kahle, founder of the Internet Archive, says that this year his team also is backing up its data to Canada.
When the election went the way that it did, it was a bit of a surprise. So we looked through the television archive at what President-elect Trump said about freedom of the press and about the internet. And what we found was shocking. He wanted to close up parts of the internet, that there was mocking of freedom of the press. This was kind of a wake-up call. And we said, let's make sure we have a copy in some other location.
What are your priorities? How does it work?
So the Internet Archive works with the Library of Congress, University of North Texas, now a growing list of groups to try to do as best we can to record the information that's available on the websites and now the web services that have been made available on .gov and .mil websites. We found in 2008, 83% of the PDFs that were available back then are no longer available even by 2012. So with an 83% loss rate when the Obama administration came on board, we are likely to see something like it, maybe even more, with the Trump administration. So we're coordinating activities to go and archive web pages, and we're reaching out to federal webmasters to go and see if we can keep whole services up and running. Can we take virtual machine versions of the databases that they're running and be able to run them in snapshot form so that we can keep these services going as they were in 2016 in the future?
Give me some examples of when the Federal Web Archive has come in handy. Was there something that you undisappeared that you were super glad to have archived?
Oh, the anecdotes go on and on. Example, there was a press release from the White House during the George W. Bush administration when he stood on an aircraft carrier and declared mission accomplished. And the headline of that press release was combat operations in Iraq had ceased. But a couple weeks later, they changed the headline and said major combat operations had ceased with no notice that it had changed. The only reason why we know is because we had archived both versions. And then a couple months later, the press release went away completely from the web. You know, what is more Orwellian? Is it changing a press release that's in the past or is it disappearing it completely?
What are you most worried is going to disappear in a Trump administration?
Frankly, we have no idea. This upcoming administration is very aware of the power of the internet and how it can be manipulated, how you can go and push things out in the middle of the night and use the journalist system in ways that are really pretty blatant. So let's at least keep a record of it.
We have just experienced the interference in a political campaign by outsiders. Is this archive secure? I mean, really secure against hacking, against intrusion?
The history of libraries is a history of loss. Libraries are burned. That's what happened to the Library of Alexandria. It'll be what happens to us. Just don't know when. So let's design for it. Let's go and make copies in other places. Let's make sure people want universal access to all knowledge, that they want education based on facts. Let's go and make sure that there is a environment that supports libraries. That's the only way that in the long term we're going to survive. And the copies that are maybe now unique at the Internet Archive will survive based on all sorts of changes, whether it's earthquakes or institutional failure or law changes.
Brewster, as always, many thanks.
Thank you very much.
Brewster Kahle is the founder of the Internet Archive and a partner on the End of Term project.
Coming up, a few words from the White House.
This is On the Media.
Hey, this is Jad from Radiolab. We're having we're celebrating a little milestone over here at Radiolab. We have been doing this. We've been making stories for the podcast, for the radio for 15 years. That is 15 years of stories about, like, the science of morality, the metamorphosis of butterflies, the legal foundation for the war on terror, all these different stories. We've been doing it for 15 years. So check out our latest episode, Out of the Archives, and all of our episodes are available wherever you get your podcasts.
This is On the Media. I'm Bob Garfield.
And I'm Brooke Gladstone. So after reviewing some of the things the Obama administration could do in the next month, we thought we'd ask, what it will do. White House Deputy Press Secretary Eric Schultz says that Obama is forging ahead with his usual civility.
We're going to do regular business. We're not going to do anything different because of Mr. Trump's agenda. Now, he has said he wanted to make a whole lot of changes, and that's his prerogative. That's what he's going to be able to do.
Right, but it hasn't been entirely business as usual. For instance, the permanent ban on Arctic drilling that was announced this week, Obama invoked a 1953 law, the Outer Continental Shelf Lands Act, so that he could act on this issue to issue the ban that Congress couldn't easily overturn. It'd have to go to the federal courts. Opponents called it an abuse of power. Supporters called it creative. Is the search on for laws like this to secure parts of his program before he has to leave?
Brooke, are you suggesting you're not intimately familiar with the Outer Continental Shelf Lands Act of 1953? Look, I take your point, but the truth is, conservation is something the president's focused on for all 8 years. So President Obama has protected hundreds of millions of acres of land and water, more than any U.S. president in history.
I wasn't trying to point to inconsistency, but rather the urgency of the action taken.
Mm-hmm.
For instance, Obama could disclose information about, say, our drone program and surveillance operations so that they can't be abused under the pretext of secrecy. Obama could make public the criteria for targeted killings and disclose the reviews of military errors.
Let me just walk you through the president's approach on this. He believes that we can keep our country safe, consistent with democratic values. And first and foremost for that is accountability and transparency. We release information on counterterrorism strikes. We release information on airstrikes in Iraq and Syria almost on a daily basis. We don't get good headlines when we put out a civilian casualties report. We don't get pats on the back for accountability or transparency, but the president still believes it's the right thing to do, and that's why he ordered his national security team to do it.
But the civilian casualty report tally is so much lower than that released elsewhere by respected sources, not necessarily politically inflected ones. They're not trusted.
We're the first administration to do it in history. We think it's a significant step in the right direction. We've moved a lot of our counterterrorism operations to the Department of Defense. That makes it easier to disclose and release information. And that's not by accident. It's never going to be enough, and transparency advocates will always be pushing for more. That's healthy. That's how the system should work. But we would put our record up to anyone in terms of what we've been able to release, what we've been able to declassify.
The record is mixed, but I don't want to argue that with you. That's not what this is about. There's also a whole body of secret legal opinions that were employed during his 8 years to justify secret practices related to intelligence, detention, interrogation, and so on. If he opened up on this, maybe, just maybe, it could help set a precedent of more vigilance toward secret law under Trump.
I don't think the next administration has shown any interest in sort of adhering to our precedent. So I don't want anyone to overstate the impact of what the Obama administration is doing on what could happen in the future. All I can speak to is what we have done, and we've, I believe, lived up to the president's commitment to be the most transparent administration in history.
Moving on to a different topic, the president has granted clemency to many federal inmates, but the process could be streamlined. Will he apply a few simple fixes to the system before Attorney General Jeff Sessions shows up and slams the door?
The president's proud of his record on this. Like he has said many times, this is a nation of second chances, and there are certain individuals serving their sentence who've demonstrated a commitment to living a better life, and the president wants to make sure that they get a chance to do that. The president, like you said, is also aware that people who are serving time have often completed their sentences if they were sentenced under current law and current regulations. And that's why the president has redoubled his efforts over the past few years through the Department of Justice to make sure that as many of these applications were being reviewed as possible.
So will he quicken the pace?
He has quickened the pace. I can say we will be granting more clemency between now and the end of the term.
He's already said there's no chance of pardoning, say, Edward Snowden, but do you have any announcements you want to make about Chelsea Manning or Bo Bergdahl?
Nope.
Okay. How about the High Court? Merrick Garland is set to return to his old job at the D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals. There has been discussion, not from the White House about the possibility of a recess appointment, or maybe simply appointing Garland to the court because the Senate will have seemed to have waived its rights to advise and consent. Any likelihood of any of that at all?
Yeah, Brooke, I'm not sure any of that's in the works. What I do think is it's really shameful that the United States Senate didn't do its job. He nominated someone who deserved to be on the bench. The Senate should have done their confirmation process, and then Chief Judge Garland could have served with distinction. The problem is the...
I think we know what the problem is. Okay. Let's move on to Guantanamo.
Okay, good, good.
He steadily reduced the number of inmates from 241 when he took office to 59. Is there anyone else that he can transfer out, or does he just have to walk away from Guantanamo now?
So we will continue to work to reduce the population at Guantanamo Bay. I think, Brooke, it's entirely possible that we see more transfers before January 20th.
How about other environmental actions? I know the president has repeatedly invoked the Antiquities Act to protect federal lands as national monuments. He's done a lot of that lately. More to come?
So maybe what I think goes unnoticed sometimes is the monuments that he designates celebrate, you know, America's greatest attributes, heroes, and personalities. The Cesar Chavez National Monument in California, or the Harriet Tubman Underground Railroad National Historical Park in Maryland, Stonewall National Monument in New York. These are new parks that ensure we pass on a more inclusive and complete story of our nation to the next generation. So it's not necessarily just about climate and conservation. It's about history and celebrating some of the greatest Americans we've ever known.
Looming over much we've discussed is the Congressional Review Act that allows the next Congress to repeal any rule issued after May 30th with a majority vote. And if a rule is repealed, the agency responsible cannot enact any regulation that is, quote, substantially the same. There's nothing the White House can do about that.
I mean, look, if they believe that the Harriet Tubman Underground Railroad National Historical Park shouldn't be designated, or if they have a compelling reason why they want to take down the Cesar Chavez National Monument in California, or if they believe we should start to drill in the Arctic and in parts of the Atlantic, they're going to have to make the argument about why, and, you know, it's certainly their prerogative.
So I can get a dim outline of the plan here. You do as much as you can, and with the passage of something, for instance, the Affordable Care Act, you at least create a political problem that the next Congress has to deal with if they want to wipe it away. So is that part of the calculation?
Well, I think the first part of your question is right. Do as much as you can. And you brought up the Affordable Care Act. So let me just say, 6.4 million people signed up for the Affordable Care Act for coverage beginning January 1st. The same period last year had 6 million people. So we're seeing growth.
Is that partly an administration effort?
You bet. We've been very aggressive spreading the word and encouraging enrollment around the country and specifically targeting the demographics that we think are important to making sure the success of the program. We've got 20 million people who now get health care under the Affordable Care Act. Republicans will have to figure out a way, if they want to roll back the Affordable Care Act, what they're going to replace it with. They've talked about repeal and replace. That's not a real thing. That's repeal and chaos. They've had 7 years to come up with an alternative, and they haven't produced one. So you're right. Congress will be in the catbird seat to figure out what to do on health care. So we'll have to see if they come up with an alternative.
Okay. Eric, thank you very much.
Good to be with you, Brooke.
Eric Schultz is the Principal Deputy White House Press Secretary.
Coming up, time. Is it running out or is it standing still?
This is On the Media.
This is On the Media. I'm Bob Garfield.
And I'm Brooke Gladstone. We've spent this hour, or to be precise, the 50 minutes and 30 seconds allotted to us, talking about what the president should consider doing before his time runs out. Time is a specter haunting this hour. Time is a train. Time is a river. Time is an arrow. James Glick, what is time?
You can't start by asking me the impossible question. Time is nature's way of keeping everything from happening at once.
So you write that people in the past didn't think about the future the way that we do now, that in fact, it was Gutenberg's printing press that actually sent us down that path?
That was the beginning of a long road, yeah. The invention of writing and then the invention of printing, that's an early version of time travel in itself. You write something down or you print it, and you are sending a message to your future self or to future generations. That was a mind-expanding concept. It's not that people didn't think about the future in a personal kind of way, right? People have been going to fortune tellers and soothsayers and palm readers since ancient times to find out what was going to happen to them.
But the future of our world, futurism, so to speak, you say that didn't hit critical velocity until the Industrial Revolution.
When you think about it, they really couldn't have before the Industrial Revolution, before technology started to change fast enough that you could see the effects in your own lives. If you took your time machine now and dropped in on a rural farmer in the 14th century and you said, so what do you imagine life will be like for your grandchildren? He would say, life is going to be the same, because life has always been the same. When things suddenly were changing so fast, it really spurred a lot of, well, as you say, futurism. Time travel, as we understand it, didn't exist really until H.G. Wells invented his time machine in 1895. The funny thing about H.G. Wells' time machine is that he starts with this quasi-scientific explanation to get his story going, that time is nothing but a fourth dimension.
I promise you, Philby, that on this machine, a man can go wherever he likes in time. By working these levers, he can choose his century, his year, his very day.
Oh, really, Professor?
Like I told you tonight, time is only a kind of space. If we can move about in all other dimensions of space, why not in time, too?
He never thought that he was creating a new theory of physics. 10 years after Wells, Einstein came along. And he, of course, created his theory of the universe in which, mathematically speaking, time is best treated as a fourth dimension, just like the three spatial dimensions.
I guess Wells's view of time was fundamentally Newtonian, right? Time exists as a series of moments. It's an absolute. That's how we experience it. And that's what Isaac Newton's cosmology demanded.
Newton invented a scientific idea of time that hadn't existed before. Before Newton, for most people, it was the psychological time that we're all familiar with. The time seems to fly faster when you're having fun or more slowly when you're bored. And for scientific purposes, he needed to define time and space as an absolute background for the universe.
But then advances in physics started chipping away at Newton's certainty. You talk about the 19th century physicist James Clerk Maxwell, who explained electricity and magnetism and light in a set of elegant equations using Newton's time, and he was able to calculate the speed of light for the first time.
That's right. And the speed of light created a problem in Maxwell's equations. And one of the people who was most troubled, of course, was Albert Einstein.
Mm-hmm.
Until suddenly he had one of those famous eureka moments that science is riddled with. His realization was that he was going to have to redefine time itself, that he was going to have to make some adjustments in Newton's notion of absolute time.
Einstein had to come up with his theory of relativity in which time and space are replaced with a single four-dimensional hole called space-time, right?
Exactly. The space-time continuum, also known as the block universe.
Mm-hmm.
You can imagine the whole thing just sitting there, and the past and the future are just directions in this four-dimensional block.
So, obviously, this feels wrong for so many reasons.
I feel your pain. If you think through the consequences, it means that our sense of free will is an illusion. Our sense that the future hasn't happened yet and we might have some control over the unfolding of events, that's an illusion, which is disturbing.
It's pretty bleak. Here's a bit of T.S. Eliot's Burnt Norton, read by the poet, which sort of sums it up.
Time present and time past are both perhaps present in time future, and time future contained in time past. If all time is eternally present, all time is unredeemable. What might have been is an abstraction, remaining a perpetual possibility only in a world of speculation. What might have been and what has been point to one end, which is always present.
I presume that by this time our listeners' heads are spinning. Poets, physicists, philosophers, psychologists, everybody was struggling to come to grips with an idea of time that was changing. It was in turmoil. And one of the symptoms of the turmoil was this new kind of storytelling that we now know as time travel. Pulp fiction writers pounding away at typewriters, trying to get a few bucks for a short story, started creating this new genre of fiction. They had to invent the rules as they went along. What happens if you use H.G. Wells's time machine not to go to the future the way he used it, but to go into the past and you shoot your grandfather dead before he has time to meet your grandmother and give birth to your mother or father? You know, then you will never be born, and so you won't be able to go back and shoot your grandfather, and so on. It's a paradox.
Let's talk about another paradox. The butterfly effect, which you've written about so brilliantly, the chaos theory. We have a clip of Homer Simpson finding himself transported back in time. It's playing off a Ray Bradbury story, A Sound of Thunder.
Okay, don't panic.
Remember the advice your father gave you on your wedding day.
If you ever travel back in time, don't step on anything, because even the tiniest change can alter the future in ways you can't imagine.
Fine. As long as I stand perfectly still and don't touch anything, I won't destroy the future.
Stupid bug! You go squish now! But that was just one little insignificant mosquito! That can't change the future, right?
Only the Simpsons would think of making the time machine a toaster. But yes, the question that you have to ask, and Ray Bradbury is the first person to ask it in this particular way in A Sound of Thunder, is what if you go back to the time of the dinosaurs and you change things? Is the progress of history in such a delicate balance that if you make a small change in the past, it has enormous consequences for the future? This is the phenomenon that chaos scientists know as the butterfly effect, which was named by the meteorologist Edward Lorenz, who proved that the flapping of a butterfly's wings in one place can change the destiny of a thunderstorm on the other side of the globe just a few weeks later. This is, you know, scientific fact.
And what happened to Homer is, in one alternate universe, Ned Flanders is a dictator. In one, Bart and Lisa are giants. And there's one where the Simpsons are rich and donuts rain down from the sky. You love this episode of Doctor Who from 2007, where the protagonist named Sally Sparrow is having a conversation with the Doctor, who is actually pre-recorded on a DVD.
Who are you?
I'm a time traveler. Or I was. I'm stuck.
1969, that's where you're talking from.
Afraid so.
But you're replying to me. You can't know exactly what I'm going to say 40 years before I say it.
38?
How? How is this possible? Tell me.
People assume that time is a strict progression of cause to effect, but actually, from a non-linear, non-subjective viewpoint, it's more like a big ball of wibbly-wobbly, timey-wimey stuff.
What's going on is another of these impossible paradoxes. Here's the Doctor, and he needs to send a message to the future, and the person in the future who's receiving the message is Sally Sparrow, played by the young Carey Mulligan in one of her earliest parts. And here's this paradoxical conversation unfolding where the Doctor is speaking to her through a TV screen. And so from her point of view, his voice is pre-recorded, and she is spontaneously coming up with her lines. She doesn't know that she's reading a script, but the Doctor is literally reading a script that has been transmitted back to the past to him by means that we don't yet understand. It's all just so tangled that you have to watch the show two or three times to figure it all out.
And it's really worth it. But you say that this exchange speaks to an experience of time travel of a sort that we all have every day.
I think that this famous episode of Doctor Who is, in an underhanded way, saying something about the world we're all living in now. All of our information coming to us on multiple screens. know, we've got our computer screen, we've got the little screen that we carry around in our pocket, and we're bombarded with voices. And sometimes it's our own voice reverberating through an echo chamber. Sometimes it's somebody we love sending us an instant message, but is it an instant message in real time, or is it a message that was sent yesterday and we're only now catching up with it? We're living with a kind of temporal confusion that is more confusing or more exhilarating than anything our grandparents had available. We've all become time travelers, for better and for worse.
So we've spent the last hour talking about the final weeks of the Obama White House, what he could do, what he should do, how the future might be altered if Obama had more time in office or he could hop into a time machine.
Poor Obama. One of the things that I think has always distinguished him is he has a sophisticated sense of time as something that passes slowly. He has more patience than the average politician. Mm-hmm. So what do you do if you're a patient man who plays a long game and you've only got a few weeks left? I don't envy him.
You say one of the standard motivators for time travel is that it's a way to cope with regret.
Yes. Why do we need time travel? Sometimes we just want a do-over. You want the version of the time machine that's going to let you go back and do it right this time. We all feel that. After all, what does time do? Time buries us. Time is a bastard.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. It's been such a pleasure.
James Glick writes about science. His latest book is called Time Travel, A History.
That's it for this week's show. On the Media is produced by Mira Sharma, Alana Casanova-Burgess, Jesse Brenneman, and Paige Cowett. We had more help from Michael Lowinger and Sara Kari, and our show was edited by Brooke. Our technical director is Jennifer Munson. Our engineer this week was Casey Holford.
Katya Rogers is our executive producer. Jim Schachter is WNYC's vice president for news. On the Media is a production of WNYC Studios. I'm Brooke Gladstone.
And I'm Bob Garfield.
Support for On the Media comes from the Overbrook Foundation and the listeners of WNYC Radio.